guys, so today is the morning of day 6. I slept in again. I was really tired after yesterday. So today is gonna be a little bit more of a down day. Well, supposedly. Today's gonna be going to the Vatican and possibly going to the Colosseum, the Roman Forum, and Palatine Hill. So it might be kind of like a morning afternoon thing. Or something like that. Yeah, it doesn't really sound like a down day to me either. But in theory, I might just take a little bit more like breaks to like sit down and maybe not do like 40,000 steps today, because that kind of sucks. I realized last night that I said that I was going to show you my lovely Bible book for my trip, and I didn't, so I'm going to do that for you guys now, so that way you understand what I'm talking about, because it's definitely something you should see. Alright, I'll show you guys right now. Hi guys, so this is my lovely book. It is approximately a little under 300 pages long. It has all the information I need for my trip, when I'm staying where. It's also doubling as a bit of a scrapbook for me. So it's got the underground that I was going to, it includes a picture, it has the time that it's open, it has the price on it, has a bit of a description for it, so that way I can kind of prepare the night before, so I have a better understanding of what I'm going to see for the day. This is my day for Pompeii. It has all the bus times, so that way I know how to get around. I'm writing notes to myself. Capitoline Hill, we were here earlier yesterday, and this is a little sneak peek of what we're going to be seeing when we go to Tivoli in the next few days. So this has all of my information that I need. It's honestly really useful. It also gives me a bit of direction. So this is for Florence, obviously. And it's got a map that I personally made that has little symbols of the things that I want to see, where I'm staying, so that way I know where I need to be, where I need to go, and if I get lost, I have something to help me out. And then I've also got like my B&B information of when check-in, check-out is, and what the place should look like, just in case. So this is my travel Bible, very important for me. And it keeps me sane, sort of-ish. Kind of, theoretically. All right, I'll see you guys later. Hi guys, so there was a little bit of running for the bus. So I guess that's at least international, always rushing for the bus because you're running late. But we're on the bus right now. So much better than walking. And we're heading towards the Vatican now. So I will see you once we're there. And then we're gonna grab some food because I am still hungry from yesterday. All right, see you guys. Here we are, guys. We are approaching the Vatican. Bus ride went perfectly fine. Everything's looking good. And I'm gonna see if I can find a tour guide so I can get a better understanding of all things Vatican and such. Hi, guys. So we're currently in a very, very long line to get into the Vatican Church. And we've been in it for about 15 minutes, and it's actually moving decently, so although it's long, hopefully it won't be time-wise long, so fingers crossed. The plaza is gorgeous. That's the basilica behind me, and we are currently moving. Hooray. Tried to find a tour, but they were either super sketchy looking or really expensive, like over 50 euros, which is translates to like $75 at least, which I wasn't a huge fan of, considering most of the places you can either go in for free or it's under 20 euros, so I didn't really think it was worth the extra, especially without knowing that it's a reputable place. So I am on my own, it seems, so far, but I'm sure I will be able to understand. Hi guys! So, as you can see, we
are almost at the front of the line, which is excellent because we've only been in line for half an hour. Now, advice for anyone coming to Rome. There are people back there who are going to be like, oh, the lines, they're 2 hours long. Skip the line. Pay us lots of money. It's a lie. It doesn't take 2 hours. Half an hour, we were like around the other side. It takes no time. Little patience goes a long way, which says a lot coming from me because I have none. So don't pay them lots of money. Be smart. Wait in the line. You'll be okay. Alright, see ya.
Hi guys, so got through the security to get into the Vatican. I'm a little bummed out because unknowingly I had my Swiss Army knife on me, you know, to cut fruit and, you know, just generally have in case of emergency, because it's a useful tool to have. And I didn't know that you're not allowed to have them when going into the Vatican, so my options were to either leave after waiting for over an hour to get in, or to throw it out. So I didn't really feel like wasting time and having to refigure out my entire day, so I tossed it, which really sucks and I'm really kind of pissed about, but it happens. And next time, obviously be more careful about what you bring. There should have been a major sign or like some sort of warning about it, because it wasn't until I got to the very front that I realized it. So that was fun. Hi guys, so we're inside the Basilica. It's absolutely gorgeous. Lots of gold gilding. Yeah, so it's mighty impressive. Highly recommended. I'll attach a photo. Hi guys, so one of the advantages of traveling alone is the fact that I blend into groups well. So I listen for English and then I follow their tour and just, you know, always stay behind the tour guide and just kind of like always have your camera out so that way you're just trying to get a picture, but it works really, really well. And then I don't need to pay because I'm on a student budget. So I've got a little bit of bad news. Yeah, today seems to have a lot of bad news. So in my tiredness last night, I forgot to recharge my camera battery. And it's not dead yet, but I'm down to one bar. So I kind of have to preserve my battery for the very important things that I want to take pictures of. So we may end up stopping back by the house sometime today so I can recharge my battery. So I'll probably do like food and let it recharge and then pick it up and then we'll keep going, and then I'll do like a full charge tonight. So we're still walking the Basilica. Huge. It's huge. Done in the Basilica for now. We're now going to try and find the Sistine Chapel. Although I loved the art inside, I'll be honest, I was a little underwhelmed by the whole thing. Not sure if it was because I didn't have a guide or an audio guide, or the fact that I had to throw my Swiss Army knife, or the fact that my camera battery is dying, but it just... So, it's like, it was lovely, it just, yeah, there's so much that could have gone better that I feel it was a little tainted by my unfortunate bad luck of the day. So I'm hoping that the Sistine Chapel will be better for after we're done in the Vatican. I'm thinking of starting to head back towards the B&B. We might honestly just walk it. It's about an hour, but honestly, an hour walking isn't really all that bad in the city because there's so much to see. That way I can charge up my battery, so that way I'm
I at least can fix one of my problems. So that's the plan for now, and hopefully there's no more problems with it.
Hi guys, so I found where the entrance to the Sistine Chapel is, and I have to say, Rome, I like. The Vatican, oh my god, I've been here for maybe like 3 hours in total. I cannot stand it. Honestly. It's like, a guy comes up to me and I'm like, no, no, like, leave me alone. And he's like, no, no, I work here. Like, you can go here and you can skip the line and it's like an extra 12 euros. And I'm like, I'm okay. And he's like, it's only an extra 12 euros. And I'm like, dude, you said that there was no money involved for you, so why do you care? First of all, and then as well, I was also told a very similar thing about skip the line when I was in front of the Basilica. And they were like, oh, it's 2 hours. And this guy's like, oh, it's an hour and a half. Reality was that it was like an hour tops. So honestly, I'm kind of looking at it like, I'm kind of indifferent whether or not I skip the line. With people being so goddamn pushy, I'm like so ready to say, screw it, head back to the B&B, charge my batteries, and go somewhere else that I actually enjoy. This is getting really pissing me off. Also, I'm looking at the line. That one, right there. It's moving. I'm like super doubtful that it's gonna be one of these like, oh, I'm gonna have to wait like an hour and a half. It's like, eh. Last admission's at 4:00. It's now 1:00. So it, even if, like, I know how long I take in areas, it's not going to be a problem either way for me. So I really don't like the whole being pushy thing. I can't stand it. It drives me insane. So I'm going to see how long people have been waiting in line. And then I will decide whether or not I feel like lining up or not. I'll check in with you guys later.
Hi guys, so we're at the Vatican Museum. Finally got inside, took about an hour or so. I've got my ticket. Good news! I was able to get it for a reduced price of 8 euros, which is fantastic. So I'm trying to kind of turn my day around and make it a little bit better. So I joined in on a tour, a little on the expensive side, but I figured my day's been going kind of crappily, so I'd rather try and, you know, turn things around a little bit. Take a tour, actually get a better understanding of what's going on, and I figured the Vatican Museum would be a good place to have a tour guide, so that way I am not completely and totally clueless of what I'm seeing. It also includes the Sistine Chapel, so we're gonna go, we're gonna see, and hopefully it's all worth it. Fingers crossed, guys. After this, we'll be heading back to the B&B. I'll see you guys later. Hi guys, so we just started the tour. Things are looking pretty good.
Toronto! Yeah!
There are a lot of Canadians on this tour. It's actually pretty great.
There we go. See?
Yeah, look at us. Look at us, all Canadian.
Yeah!
The tour is looking pretty good so far. Good explanations, good English.
Oh, yeah.
And the day is definitely taking an upturn.
We got another Canadian couple actually up there.
Yeah, they were from Winnipeg.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Where are you from? Oh, you're from Toronto as well.
Yeah. Right. All right, I'll see you guys later.
Not as famous, but they're all essentially powerhouses of a movement we refer to today in art as the pre or early Renaissance. So with all these guys working the space, how come it's only Michelangelo's name that anyone ever remembers? The question's never really been asked, at least in any of the books that I've ever picked up, but I think it's an important one to ask and a simple one to answer. These guys were great artists, but they weren't working as individuals. They're working as one unit. The minute you start suppressing individual style, what makes an artist great in the first place, you rob him of his creativity and create bad art. It's kind of like forcing someone like Salvador Dali to paint like Pablo Picasso. It just doesn't work. So we're going to deal with, for the most part, Michelangelo, a little bit with Raphael. These guys, at their core, they were completely different people. Michelangelo is a guy that was extremely good at what he did, but he was arrogant, he didn't work well with people. For him, it was always about the art. He cared little for the celebrity or the status that came alongside it. Raphael, on the other hand, was completely the opposite way. He was like Kanye West, before Kanye West. He had an entourage of about 30 people that followed him everywhere. Men and women that wanted to be him or be with him. He loved the celebrity, he loved the status. The only thing that he didn't love is the fact that everyone in Rome knew there was someone better than him, and he wanted that top position. Artistically speaking, he wasn't as good as Michelangelo, at least not as diverse. He had to find a way around getting it, and this is what he does. He befriends the Pope. While he's friendly with the Pope, he says to the Pope, you know what, I don't think it's a very good idea that you create your funeral monument while he's still alive. It may be a bad omen. The Pope hadn't thought about it like this before, but as soon as Raphael speaks these words to him, he can't get them out of his head. He doesn't want Michelangelo to continue the project. But this was supposed to be a lifelong project for Michelangelo. He needs to give him something good in return. He doesn't know what. Raphael steps in again and says, hey, I've got an idea. Why don't you get Michelangelo to paint the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel? I'm sure he'll do a banging job, he says. It's a great project for a painter. Michelangelo's not a painter, he was a sculptor. So essentially what Raphael was trying to do, discredit him as an artist, leave him a spotlight for himself, Tonya Harding style. But of course it all backfires. So that's Michelangelo's head on the plate, showing again how little he really wanted to paint the ceiling. It's how he decided to sign the work. Right across from there, David slaying the Philistine warrior Goliath, the bronze and serpent, the punishment of Haman. The two largest figures in the work, Zechariah on the top, Jonah at the bottom. Going all the way around the work, we have an alternating scheme of sibyls and prophets who during the time of Michelangelo were held in similar esteem as they both predicted events into the future. Triangles between them, eight in total, the ancestors of Christ from Mary's side. Now the most famous panels, the ones that people remember, are the ones down the center. These are stories from the book of Genesis. They go back to front, except the second one and the third one, for some reason, these are the wrong way around. Starting at the top, we have the drunkenness of Noah, showing that Noah was a guy like all the rest of us. Occasionally went out and did Jaeger bombs. Flood scene, the sacrifice of Noah, the expulsion from the Garden of Eden, and the first sin within one caption. In the first bit, we have the serpent tempting Eve to eat the apple, luring her in. In the latter part, they're being kicked out of the garden by the angel of God. Eve looks back, cringing, embarrassed, as if to blame the serpent for what's just happened to them. Adam looks forward aggressively, as if to blame his wife. Nothing's changed. Creation of Eve, dramatically smaller than the figures that come later. Reason being, Michelangelo is uncomfortable around women. A lot of people say, was he homosexual? Nothing to substantiate this. Many homosexual artists during that period, none of them hid their sexuality. If anything, Michelangelo is probably asexual. At the age of 15, he was dramatically disfigured by a jealous artist who attacked him with a mallet, one of these huge mallets they use for carving rock. Smashed him in the face, broke his nose, disfigured him for life, and after this, Michelangelo didn't like people very much. As a person, he kept himself to himself. As an artist, he needed models. He always used males, he felt more comfortable around them. This is why his female figures are very muscular, just with female facial characteristics. To give you an idea of the kind of women Michelangelo would have normally painted, that, believe it or not, is a woman. Check out the guns on that woman, the arms on her. Well, this woman right over here, look how muscular she is. It's like a cross between Pam Anderson and Arnold Schwarzenegger. Anyway. Creation of Eve, creation of Adam, separation of sea and sky, creation of the planets, sun, moon, another moon, I'll explain why in a minute, and the separation of light and dark. He works from the top all the way down. This is why the figures gradually get bigger and fewer as you go along. It's said that after about a year, he noticed what he painted was now starting to crack. Mold is growing and forming in those cracks. He leaves it up there, it's literally going to flake off in a year, and he doesn't know what to do. He scratches everything off and he starts over again from the beginning. It's the end of the second year now, he's only at this point. The rest was done in a 2-year period. This panel should have taken him a week, took him one day to do, working against the clock. Now the Pope is eager to see how his money's being spent. Michelangelo wants to keep the Pope out, he hasn't done that much work. Every day the Pope tried to get in, every day he would get blocked. He went on for 2 years. In the end, the Pope doesn't give up. He simply changes the game. He doesn't knock anymore, just takes off his papal garments, puts on workman's clothes, all spattered with paint, and he slips in with a workman. No one recognizes him. Gets all the way up to the top. Just about to look at the ceiling, Michelangelo's busy working at the other side of the room, doesn't think, instinctively grabs for the closest thing to him. Happened to be a plank of wood. Stood up, threw it at the Pope, hit the Pope in the face. You can imagine, not a good idea. Any period in time, especially not this period, especially not this Pope. This Pope during his reign was referred to as El Terrible, the Terrible One, the Warrior Pope. Tried to kill the former Pope Rodrigo Borgia twice while a cardinal. So as a cardinal, he's got no problem taking out a Pope. As a Pope, he's going to have no problem taking out an artist. Michelangelo, understanding this, runs away to Florence, gets protected by the Medicis until the Pope calms down. In the meantime, tit for tat, Bramante, rival of Michelangelo, friend of Raphael, has a spare set of keys. Raphael's hoping that Michelangelo's blocked the job, he can take over the project and shine it and do what he does best. That was the plan. Goes inside there, looks, takes down the scaffolding. Raphael's a painter by trade. Michelangelo is sculptor. These guys hate each other, but when Raphael sees what Michelangelo's achieved, he's so impressed, he actually changes his style of frescoing to copy or mirror that of Michelangelo. So by the time Michelangelo gets back to Rome, two and a half months later, he noticed one of two things. One, Raphael's ripped off his new technique, and two, the initial figures are way too small. So from this period onwards, he makes the figures gradually get bigger and fewer. Now, addressing his feud with the Pope, Michelangelo decides forgive and forget. It's the Pope. Can't really go up against this guy. It was very common during that period to replace biblical and historical figures in the works of art with people the artist knew. Raphael did this all the time, Michelangelo didn't. It's the one and only time he decides to paint the Pope into one of his works. But where does he appear? Not as the Pope, but symbolically as this muscular-looking woman, the Kenyan civil. She was most known for predicting the great revival in arts and culture. Julius II felt the Renaissance was that great revival. He felt he was the reason it was all happening. Michelangelo knew this, knew what the Pope felt about this woman, and so he paints the Pope's head on the woman's body, tells the Pope, and he liked the gesture. To get his own back, Michelangelo paints in two cupids, or cherubs, that are watching the Sibyl work. One of them has their arm perched on the other one's shoulder, looking down at the Sibyl, and is making that symbol. That is the Italian equivalent in those days for up yours. Michelangelo's little up yours to the Pope for giving him such a hard time. He covered his own back by painting in that so small that the Pope never actually noticed it, which he didn't. It was only officially discovered 80 years ago when people first started examining the ceiling with binoculars. That was by what he saw. Why? Today we're seeing the censored version. When Michelangelo initially painted this, the only figures originally that had clothes on were Mary and Christ. Everyone else is completely naked. Now, for a man of the cloth, this isn't a good thing. He tells the Pope's not pleased. Of course, Michelangelo sits him down and says, "What the hell are you doing?" Michelangelo's put on the spot, needs to come up with something. This was his retort. He said, "Look, I'm not going to lie to you. It's true the figures are naked, but it's not pornography. God created us naked without clothes. Therefore, anything created by God cannot be seen as pornographic, sacrilegious by anyone, especially the church." Ooh. Much later on, Larry Flint tried to use that same excuse for his magazine. Didn't work for him, worked for Michelangelo. Now to finish the job with the Pope's blessing. Not forgetting how this guy betrayed him, Michelangelo never forgot a grudge. He immortalized that poor man right over here in the right-hand corner for ratting him out. This is a bigger version. Takes Badger's head, superimposes it on Minos' aging body. Imprisons him within the lowest realm of Catholic hell, represented by the serpent coiled around his body twice. His genitalia being attacked by a snake, and to add insult to injury, he gives him donkey ears. Had this been today, this would have blown up Snapchat. In those days, though, word of mouth spread pretty fast. Everyone wanted to see it. Everyone's making fun of the guy. The guy was so embarrassed, he gave up his position, moved to Florence, and was never seen of or heard of in the city again.
Hi, guys. Tour is going excellently well, as you can tell. I knew a few of the things mentioned. Very proud of that fact. Yay, research. Yeah. Apparently, my art history knowledge is not terrible, which I'm okay with. The tour is actually going really well, and I'm really enjoying it, and the day seems to be finally turning towards a better turn, which is really nice, because I really didn't want to have a bad day. Bad days aren't fun. So, things are looking good. I'm very happy. Unfortunately, no pictures in the Sistine Chapel, because it's not allowed, and I don't want to get kicked out. Because there was a guy on one of these tours last week, and he wanted to feel what one of the tapestries felt like. So he, like, gave it such a hard tug, almost fell to the floor, got tackled by 3 guards. I told you, tackling by guards does happen. So, don't want that to happen to me, considering they are clearly well-practiced in it from last week. So, we're gonna follow the rules. Look on the internet if you want to see the Sistine Chapel, I guess. Alright, see you guys!
Apollo appearing with a lyre, the musical instrument he's most closely associated with. The most famous work, though, is the work dominating the center of the room. It's another Greek original. It dates back to the 1st century. Simply referred to as the Belvedere Torso, and it's highly inspirational to study in anatomy of all the Renaissance artists, but the most fond of it was Michelangelo. He liked the piece so much, he stole it from its original seating point inside that courtyard, took it into his own private studio, refused to give it back to the Pope for 2.5 years. During that 2.5 year period, he made very good use of it. He sketched it from all different angles.
Even with my readings and all the research I've done, having someone actually there to explain it and answer your questions is a really nice way to see things, and it also gives you a more in-depth understanding of what's going on and just points out like little things that unless you've done like a whole lot of research, you don't get it. So that's good. My tour guide's also done tours of the
Coliseum, so I'm going to ask him if he has any suggestions for that for later. Right. Fortunately, I was also able to get some recommendations for tours for the Coliseum. Grant, the tour guide that I had, was kind enough to give me two tour suggestions that I can look up on the internet, so I can look at some prices and figure that out, and their meeting places, and he honestly provided like a really nice tour, so I trust his recommendations. So when I'm back at the B&B, I will look into those, and I'll either go on one of them either today or tomorrow, probably tomorrow or later on this week, because it's already, I think, what time is it? It is? Yep, it's 4 o'clock. So I don't want to feel rushed on my tour, or I don't want to feel rushed if I want to look around more, because double buying tickets is not fun. So we're going to keep on moving for right now, and I will see you guys later. Bye. Hi guys, so just stopped for a little bite to eat. Caprese sandwich yet again, very yummy. So I'm highly considering getting one of those little USB chargers that those little annoying people have, only because my battery on my phone gets really low really close to the end of the day. And although I'm not having that problem today, in case I do have that problem in the future, I really don't want to feel like I can't, you know, spend this great quality time with you guys. So I'm thinking if I can get a decent price on one, I might pick one up so that way we can spend more time together, because I know you enjoy this as much as I do. Hi guys. Okay, so I took a bit of a sit down because my legs hurt and they're still tired and I'm tired. So we're now moving again. We are heading towards a place called the Mouth of Truth, which is in a small garden, so I'm expecting like a statue or something. Then we are going to continue on to the Baths of Calcala. And once we're done there, we're probably 1 or 2K away from the B&B at that point. So we're gonna beeline it back to the B&B. We're gonna B&B the line. That was terrible. And then we're gonna recharge back. Hi guys! So we're at the Mouth of Truth, and it's a small park, and it's actually quite nice. And the steps are really steep, and I hate that, because I feel like I'm gonna fall on my face. But in this vicinity, I'll show you right now, we've got this lovely building on my left. And around, we've got this lovely building on my left again. And actually really nice. Rather nice, and a nice little walk between major streets. Don't feel like I'm gonna get hit by a car at this very moment, which is kind of nice for a change. We're at the back side of the Roman Forum, which is just over there. I'm actually getting a pretty good feel for, well, not like all of Rome, but like when I see something, I'm like, I know what this is. Having a map also helps, so can't take, like, I guess full credit, but I'm going to anyways because I'm just that kind of person. Guys, so still walking towards the baths. I've got more of the Roman Forum over here. Everything's to my left today. I turn around, now it's on my right side though. See, changing things up. Always gotta keep it interesting. So we're still walking, and I had a thought. Although I clearly love walking so much, you know, with the blisters and the pain and how like my feet want to fall off and die, I kind of wish I had like my rollerblades or a bike, just to kind of like, it's a different set of muscles, so that way I got like a little bit of a rotation, so that way, you know, a little less effort and a little bit more coasting along and just, you know, looking around. Although I'd probably get hit and die by like Vespa or car in the first like 5 minutes that I was on it, but you know, for those 5 minutes it would be like real nice. So maybe next time.
Alright. Lonely. I am so lonely. I've got nobody. I'm on my own. So we finally made it to the Baths of Caracalla, and I got bad news. It's closed. But since I walked all the way here, I wanted to at least take a look at what I could see from, you know, the closed gate. Because honestly, I just don't have the energy to hop the fence. Because it honestly actually looks pretty nice. So quick turnaround. So, similar to the Roman forums, ruins, used to be gyms and shops, would have about 8,000 people coming through here daily, back when, you know, it wasn't ruins. Did a little reading up on it. It closed an hour before sunset, and oh look, the sun's not set, which means I just missed it. Of course, because it's me, and today is not my lucky day. But it still looks nice, it still looks pretty. I'm just not gonna get to see the whole thing. At least not today. I might do it a different day because this isn't too far from my place. But for any of you that wanna like actually Google this, because I don't have internet here, or else I'd honestly be telling you how many kilometers I just walked. Because I went from the Vatican and then essentially followed the river down, which like goes like this, by the way. So it's not even like it's a straight line. So I just did a lot of walking, and at this point I'm just gonna walk all the way home, and then I might honestly just stay there because it's been a lot of walking. But I walked all the way from the Vatican, remember? So pretty far. That's from like central slash northern Rome to like the south, where I'm staying at Gibraltella station, something like that. There's a G and Tella in it. I think Nutella. I don't know. Yeah, so we're gonna, I don't even know what the trip, no, we're gonna walk this way. I haven't walked this way. So we're gonna head home and I'm gonna recharge some batteries. And might just call it a night and have dinner somewhere nearby, because I've been doing a lot of walking in the past 2 days and I'm honestly not used to it yet. So my feet are kind of sore and I'd rather not have to take a full day off from sightseeing because of my feet. But if they keep bothering me, then it might be better for me to take a day off to just kind of sit, relax, maybe watch like a TV show or something on my phone, and then get back to it the next day. There are some bats here, by the way. I'm not sure if you can see any of them, but there are a couple bats. We're getting a nice view of this, so we're gonna walk backwards for a bit so you can see them. Yeah. But that's what's happening currently, and hopefully my feet kind of get with the program, because the walking isn't going to stop for like 2 more months. Once I'm back in Canada, like, I'm going to go straight back to being like super lazy, not getting out of bed till noon, parents bitching at me. It'll be great. Hi guys, so lovely Baths of Caracalla, which is great, except there was a guy and he's following me in his car. Super fucking creepy. Like, he got out of his car earlier while I was walking like around the perimeter, and I just kind of, you know, sped up, walked away, and then he drove like up the road and then he pulled over to the side, and it's like I'm keeping eyes on him only because of the fact that I want to make sure that if he's gonna hop out of this car, I'm ready to run. And it's like, I can see through the window, he's like, he's smiling at me, like, yeah. And I'm like, oh, dear God, no. So, yeah, there goes his car. ES621 something, black SUV thing. If I go missing, look at it. Hi guys. So, still walking, but I'm almost home. Almost. So I need to get better at recognizing distances on maps. What I thought was 3 kilometers total. Well, yeah, no, it wasn't. It was like 7. So I'm walking and my feet are gonna fall off. So I think tomorrow's gonna be a mandatory stay home kind of day. I might go out to like a little market to get some food, but that's about it. Yes, the ever lovely bridge. Yay, bridge. Cause my feet are gonna fall off. I'm in so much pain.